one of the greatest game freaks caught our imagination. August 28, 1965, Satoshi Tajiri, the creator of the cultural poke phenomenon, evolved from embryo to infant, which is a lame, pun-strung way of saying he was born. The franchise that became the face of the late 90s was the product of childhood experience. The same way that exploring forests and dark caves as a kid influenced Shigeru Miyamoto in his design of The Legend of Zelda, two passionate pastimes in Tajiri's juvenile days came together to become pocket monsters. The first was his creepy, crawly appetite for collecting insects, and the second was video games. Growing up in the golden age during his formative teenage years, the arcades, and in particular the game that caused the Japanese mint to run out, Space Invaders, became too much a part of his life to ignore, much to the chagrin of his parents. But though gaming may have been golden, it was about to get a little more colorful. Tajiri founded his own fan magazine called Game Freak, which would bring him into collaboration with artist Ken Sugimori, 151 of whose illustrative works would become more valuable than either of them could ever fathom. Game Freak ultimately became a video game company in 1989, and only a year later, the idea for a new project came into being. With the massive success of the Game Boy and with its ability to connect to another Game Boy via connector cable, Tajiri envisioned the opportunity to take his fascination with collecting creatures as a kid and turning that into a game, letting other kids get captured by the same allure. After years of a long development cycle in which Game Freak nearly bankrupted itself, and after a healthy span of titles including Mendel Palace and Yoshi, the captured imagination of Satoshi Tajiri was set loose. Pokemon became the greatest selling RPG of all time, right across American and Japanese markets. Its accessibility as a role-playing game, but one that just as easily catered to the hardcore, its enormous replay value with its incentive of catching them all, collecting all of its species of wildlife, and the myth of Mew, of a secret Pokemon hidden in the game, made it a massive success. It was something unique, and for one of the first times, its gameplay was not destructive. You weren't killing guys, you were capturing them and making them do your bidding in battle. Okay, I guess that's just as bad. I jest, of course, this was no promoter of despotic ideals. Much like the relationship of the romanticized American traveler and his loyal steed, this was about a friendship forged out of tribulation. Cooperation, partnership, and teamwork. These were the synonymous values upheld by Tajiri's handheld triumph. Pokemon was about socializing and duality, right down to its doubled release as Red and Blue, or Red and Green as was its original release in Japan. It became the talk of the playground, but it became so much more when, taking a page out of other merchandising empires like Star Wars, it crossed into every facet of media and used an anime series and a trading card game to complement its concept of collection. Though the franchise does not quite have the universal gravity that it did a little more than a decade ago, Pokemon's influence is hardly irrelevant and can still be felt in video games and pop culture. Otanjoubi omete to gozaimasu, Tajiri-san. Happy birthday, good sir, on this fine August 28th.